branch. And so, unfortunately, he's unable to be with us tonight because he is doing a tour in London. But we're thrilled to have Matthew Skoller, also Logan Center Blues Fest director, playing both the interviewer as well as joining Deitra for some tunes. So we're very grateful to him for the role that he's playing both with the Blues Festival as well as with Second Monday Blues here tonight. And so if you aren't familiar with the format, one of the things that we're doing as part of the Blues Initiative is focusing also on archiving the stories of musicians living here in Chicago. And so we start each of the Second Monday Blues programs with an interview. And so Matthew will be interviewing Deitra. There will be a set, there will be a short intermission, and then a second set. So that's what you're in for tonight. I'd also like to thank Charles Rumbach, who helps me with this series as well, who you may see, who also sometimes does these intros, and he's the jazz and blues coordinator here at the Logan Center. I'd also like to thank our funders, the Jonathan Logan Family Foundation and the Reva and David Logan Family Foundation, for their support of blues at the Logan Center, as well as this series, and the upcoming Save the Date Logan Center Blues Fest, which will be happening October 16th, 17th, and 18th. So please do save the date. Make sure that you're in town. We hope to be announcing the headliners by the end of this month. And we also hope to be announcing a performance that we'll be doing on May 31st as part of the Year of Chicago Music and their 17-day festival, combining a lot of the festivals happening downtown and a lot of energy happening around the city. So there will be a blues program here at the Logan Center as part of the Blues Initiative, also as part of the Year of Chicago Music. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Matthew Skoller.
So tonight, we're going to be talking with and listening to one of the great blues singers anywhere in the world today. And as we say in the business, that ain't no stage joke. Deitra Farr is considered one of Chicago's top vocalists. I'm reading from her bio here. And she's one of the world's top vocalists, actually. I'm sorry to correct your website, but. According to Living Blues magazine, she's fiery, energetic, and soul-stirring. That describes this woman who has, over the years, been nominated for Traditional Female Blues Artist of the Year by the, what we used to call the W.C. Handy Awards, Female Blues Artist of the Year by the Living Blues Critics Awards, the British Blues Connection Awards, and Les Trophées France Blues Awards. On October 4th, 2015, Deitra was inducted into the Chicago Blues Hall of Fame as a legendary blues artist. On December 9th, 2016, the National Soul, Southern Soul Foundation gave Deitra the Most Popular Blues Artist Award. Deitra is also the recipient of the 2017 Just Blues Music Foundation's Coco Taylor Queen of the Blues Award. So with no further ado, put your hands together for my big sister, everybody. Deitra Farr, let's hear it for her. I come to this, yes, yes. Keep going. I come to this with a disadvantage. I don't know Deitra very well, I had to do some studying and some research on this. We've only been playing together for 33 years. So you can see that I might have had to do a little digging. And
you gonna ask me some juicy questions?
No, just your normal fare. When did you know you wanted to be a singer? How old were you? What was that about?
Well, my earliest recollection was looking at the Ed Sullivan Show. And the Supremes came on. And I said, oh yeah, that's what I want to do. I don't remember anything before that.
How old were you?
Six.
6 years old.
And now I'm 62.
Mm-hmm. Tell it all.
I have no secrets. Well, I have some, but.
This woman can hold water, I will tell you right now.
Yes,
she can hold on.
I have lots of secrets.
Yes. And so I know, because we just met, that 33 years ago, that in high school you had a teacher who would prove at Kenwood High School, right here on the south side of Chicago.
Yes.
You had a teacher who would prove to be very important in your development. Can you talk about her and her effect on your trajectory as an artist?
I graduated from Kenwood High School right here in the neighborhood, class of 75. And Lena McLean was my, she was my music teacher, my choir teacher, whatever you want to call it, vocal teacher. And, you know, it was amazing. You know, she would make us do what we didn't think we could do. And if you didn't do what she said, she would say, somebody go get my purse. And we knew what that meant. That meant the stick pin. That's when we used to have corporal punishment in school. They need to bring some of that back. Nobody ever got stuck because we did what we were told. But I remember one day she said, I said, Miss Maglin, I'm depressed. And she said, that's good, you'll sing better. So I'm a blues singer. I took that depression and did something with it. Okay? So yeah, she was a great teacher and, oh man, I could talk 40 minutes, you know, we don't even have time to talk about Lena McLean, but she was the, is the niece of Thomas A. Dorsey, who is the father of gospel music. And I was blessed enough to go see him because of what she told me. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't have known about him if it weren't for her. So I'm blessed. I'm one of the few living people that actually saw him, you know, conduct choirs and everything. So,
and in terms of the mechanics of singing, and what did she impart to you that you remember?
Singing from the diaphragm, you know, singing correctly. Mm-hmm. She made us do that. I mean, the choir was an amazing experience, you know. Mm-hmm. We just did so many things. It's hard to even think of it now. It's been so many years ago. But she had a great influence on me.
And you still draw from her influence?
Yes, I still talk to her to this day.
Right.
She's 91 years old, I believe.
So,
yeah.
Your first record was with a group called Mill Street Depot, and it was a song called You Won't Support Me. It was released in 73, correct?
Is that 76.
76, okay. Can you talk about your relationship to soul and R&B music, and how and why you transitioned into blues music?
Well, my age group, our music, our soundtrack was Motown, Stax, you know, soul music. Blues was played in my house. That's what my dad played, you know. And I always loved it, and I saw nothing wrong with it. In fact, in third grade, I took a Lightning Hopkins record to school for show and tell. That didn't go over too big. I still have the record. It's called Backdoor Friend. I still have it. Daddy, can I have that record? I'm gonna take it to school, you know, and my friends made fun of me. But I saw nothing wrong with blues. I wasn't one of these people that came from a family that thought blues was the devil's music. My dad played blues. So I started off singing in soul bands in Chicago. And while I was working on the University of Chicago campus at the Shoreland Hotel, which used to be a dormitory here on campus. Some of y'all know that, yeah. I was a desk clerk while I was in college. And Phil Guy came to the school, to the dormitory to do a show for the kids.
Younger brother to Buddy Guy.
Yes. And somebody came to my desk and said, D, I bet you won't go up there and sing with that band. I said, I bet I will. And I jumped up and went over there and I said, excuse me, can I sing a song? And I sang Steal Away with Phil Guy's band. And when the band took a break, he invited me to come to his gigs at the Checkerboard Lounge, Teresa's, all those blues clubs. And I just happened to be old enough to get in. I was like 21, you know. So he is the reason why I'm a blues singer, because it started from that. Somebody daring me to sing. Can I tell you how I started singing with my first band?
Yeah.
My uncle.
You do whatever you want up here, man.
No, don't tell me that, because I'll do that. When I was 7 years old, I went to a Park District show that my uncle, he was in a band, soul band, and they had a female vocalist. Remember, I'm 7 years old. And I said, hey, when you guys get tired of her, give me a call. This is 7 years, you know me. 10 years later, she quit. And my aunt called me and she said, well, you can audition, but it don't mean you're gonna get the job. And I said, okay. So I auditioned and I got the job.
Nice.
That started my career.
Not surprised.
Well, you know me, so.
Yeah. So you have a lot of different talents, actually. And you're a published writer, you're a poet, you're a songwriter. You're a painter. You graduated from Columbia College with a Bachelor's of Arts in Journalism. You've recorded many of your own compositions, and you've written articles for the Chicago Daily Defender, the Chicago Blues Annual, the Italian blues magazine Il Blues, currently, and for the last, I don't know, maybe 12 or 14 years?
15 years
now. You've had a column in our most respected periodical in blues music, which is Living Blues, called Artist to Artist, which is you interviewing our colleagues. And can you tell us what that experience has been like?
It's interesting because most journalists ask questions that some of us get tired of being asked. And because I am one of us, my problem is getting people to shut up. Because we get on the phone and it's like, and I'm like, I only got one page, you know. But it's fun to talk to my peers. Mm-hmm. And we have a shared experience, you know, where other journalists who are just journalists, they don't know what we're talking about or what we're going through. So it makes people open up to me that they normally wouldn't open up to another journalist, so.
No, absolutely, and you get.
And you know, everybody in this room has more than one talent, everybody. And I'm just one of these people that's arrogant enough to use as many of them as I can, you know? I don't see why I can't do more than one thing.
It's actually arrogant to not utilize all the gifts you've been given. You take responsibility for the gifts you've been given, and you develop all of them and have become accomplished at a lot of different things. So I'm a witness. And so being an expository writer, a creative writer, being a blues singer, being a teacher, you taught in Chicago public schools for years.
10 years.
Yeah.
I raised my son through Chicago public schools because blues just wasn't gonna cut it.
And being a painter.
That was a dare too.
And so.
I am not a good painter.
I like your work.
You do?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Well, we're all learning things tonight.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got this degree in journalism, you've worked as a painter, you're a poet, you're a songwriter. When you first arrived on the blues scene in Chicago, there weren't a lot of other women blues singers who had the kind of diversity of interests that you had and the kind of abilities to communicate in many different parts of society and parts of the community. And you were, I'll put it this way, you were not the club owner stereotype of a blues mama, as many have called women blues artists over the years. I find it a little derogatory, actually. But and it starts to become part of what pigeonholes stereotypes. And so how did, what was that experience like, and how did it affect your career?
That was very difficult, very painful, and I'm easily triggered. And you know what I went through a couple of weeks ago. Yeah, I'm triggered by that experience. I came into the blues. First of all, I graduated from college, and I decided to become a blues singer. And my dad almost killed me. You went to college to be a blues singer? What's wrong with you? That's what I want to do. So I came into the blues scene, thanks to Phil Guy. And at that time, I was skinny. That's over with now, but I was 110 pounds when I became a blues singer, and I appeared to be educated. I didn't go around telling anybody, but people can tell a little bit. And I was told, you don't look like a blues singer, you don't act like a blues singer, you're too educated to be a blues singer. I was too everything. And so I struggled. I wasn't Southern born, I was born in Chicago. Most of the blues singers back at that time were Mississippi born or Alabama or somewhere. I mean, I was raised by those kind of people. My family comes from Mississippi, but I was born here, Southside. And they tried to deter me from being what I was, but I stayed in it because of the elders. They embraced me. And I thought, okay, the club owners don't like me, the young white guys who are the authorities on the blues, they think, they don't like me. But Sunnyland likes me. Mm-hmm. Eddie Taylor likes me. Mama Yancey likes me. Sam Lay likes me. He took me on the road, you know? I mean, they like, the people that are the blues people liked me. So I stayed. And I've been doing it, you know, all these years.
And now all those club owners who didn't give you any gigs and dissed you, they're all knocking on her door trying to get her to come into their little clubs.
And I'm arrogant as hell.
She's not interested.
I am not interested. I am arrogant as hell.
And, well, you also are principled, and you don't, you know, sort of compromise your principles for rent money.
Yeah, and I've sung in over 45 countries. So I'm like, I must be doing something right.
Absolutely.
People not gonna send for you to come. I've been to Russia 3 times. I've been to Israel, Sweden. I've been to every country in Europe, I think. I mean, China. You took me to Japan, Brazil, Australia. I've been everywhere, but the electric chair.
So, and you've seen everything but the wind.
Okay.
So in 1987, just to wrap this up, because we're going to play music for you right now, is that all right?
Yeah.
Just give you a little idea. In 1987, I moved to Chicago and started playing with a few different groups. And one night, just a few weeks after I got here, I got a phone call. Hello, is Matthew there? And I said, yeah. Well, listen, my name is Deitra Farr, and I heard you're a really good harmonica player. I have never hired anybody without hearing them play first, but are you working tomorrow night?
True story.
And I said, no, I'm not working tomorrow night. So I went down to Blue Chicago, and she liked what I was doing, and we've been playing on and off together for the last 33 years. I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. And we're playing at Blue Chicago tomorrow.
That's right. We're playing.
Same club.
We play there every Tuesday night. And
536 North Clark.
Yeah, Clark and Ohio Street. So with all of that, I would love it if you'd all give this wonderful queen of the blues a big round of applause. Deitra Farr.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And I want to acknowledge my very good friend, Miss Lynn Jordan, legendary Miss Lynn Jordan. Yeah. All right. How about it for Matthew Skoller, y'all? Yeah. I'm bragging about my man.
what I think he would do to show me his love for me is true. Well, I've had some affairs that were really bad, but now he gives me the treatment I should have always had. Now I don't worry when he's out of my sight. Knowing I don't worry where he was last night. 'Cause he was here with me where he wanted to be. His love for me is clear. Oh, he wouldn't be. Once again, y'all, Tom Holland on the guitar. There should be no question that he loves and he cares. Whenever you need him, he tries to be there. He wants to see you happy, keep sadness away. He wants to be with you quite a bit every day. His eyes follow your steps, and he can look in your eyes. You know you can trust him. He doesn't sit there and lie. He'd do anything for you any time of the day. Oh, he doesn't mind going. They do. Hey, that's what they do.
Too bad it ain't true. We got any blues lovers in here tonight? Oh, good. You too young, what you know about this? Oh, Lordy, Lordy. Don't worry my life anymore. So many nights since you've been gone, I've had to worry my life alone. But someday, baby, ain't gonna worry my life anymore. No more, baby. How many times since you've been away, I've had to cry both night and day. But someday, baby, ain't gonna worry my life anymore. Ain't that right, Brother Scott? Woo, somebody better come here. That's why I hired him, y'all. Matthew Skoller, y'all, give it up. Thank you.
place I go. How much I love you. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So that takes care of ex-husband number one. To be fair, you know I'm an equal opportunity blues singer. I do one for the second one.